Hello learners,
I'm Dr. Laila Simon, Associate Professor from the Department of Management of the Bhopal School of Social Sciences. And today we are going to together learn scaling techniques. As we just hear about scaling techniques, what comes to our mind is the scales and the measurements. And when it comes to research, we talk about four main scales. Let's have a look on them. When we hear about scaling techniques, what comes to our mind are the major four scaling techniques that has been used. Like we have the nominal scale, we have the ordinal scale, we have the interval scale, and of course the higher order scale, which is the ratio scale. Now, when you look at into the other scaling techniques, which is going to be the major discussion of the day today, we have comparative scale and non-comparative. So with the name itself, you come to know we compare something, so you call it as comparative. And if we don't compare, we just work out on one particular object and try to identify the goodness or the badness in it, we call it as a non-comparative one. So let's have a look on what do these scales talk about. By the way, when we talk about scaling techniques, it's actually a method of placing the respondents in continuation of gradual change in a pre-assigned value, maybe symbols, numbers, based on the features of a particular object as whatever be the defined rules are. All the scaling techniques are based on major four pillars. We call it as. And what are these pillars? These pillars are the order, the description, the distance, and of course the origin. So we were talking about the nominal scale. We have the nominal scale. What does it indicate? It actually indicates numbers. Nominal stands for a category. You're talking about male or you're talking about a female. So we can just put numbers as one or two as an indicator. So what is that number indicating? It doesn't indicate a value, but what does that indicate? It indicates a category. One belongs to male or two belongs to female. We have ordinal scale, as we told. Ordinal scale is something where we are putting the numbers, but these numbers don't have actual values, but they have an order. And the most important, what we learn about the metrics, that is, we're talking about numbers with the values, are the interval scale and also the ratio scale. This is very important, as here the numbers has some amount of value. But when it comes to the ratio scale, there is one important term that most of you might have come across, is the absolute zero, which also doesn't mean that it's zero, so it doesn't have a value, but it's the importance of zero is you are putting, say for example, when talking about maybe 2 on 4 will have a same ratio. What is the ratio? The ratio is to 1:4, or I say 1:2, or I say it is 1/2. So we are looking at a fixed origin from where the ratio scale can be measured. But in the interval scale, you have fixed interval, like in the case of a thermometer. What do you have? You have a regular intervals. You have 0, you have 10, you have 20. So you will find the difference between the divisions are the same. So let's look into more of details of these scales that I've mentioned here. So let's have a detailed look and a quick review of what we have learned in the past. What are the main characteristics and how are these examples taken up in the four different scales? So if we look at nominal scale, we have, they are using numbers. And what are these numbers used for? As I just said, we make use of these numbers to define or identify a category, maybe a male or a female. Now, when you look at the common examples, what are the common examples? The phone number doesn't have a value, but these are numbers and indicating a particular person or identity, right? So it has social security numbers, or maybe some kind of numbers that are being allotted to football players or maybe the athletes. We have the marketing examples like brand numbers are there, where the brands have just number indicating its category, or maybe the store types. Now, what do we use for calculating when it is a nominal scale? We use either percentages or we make use of mode for the calculations. And when it comes to the permissible statistics, we are making use of the chi-square or the binomial test. Similarly, a quick wind on what is the ordinal. So when it is ordinal, they have relative positions. That is what we have to keep in mind. We have say one, rank one, we have rank two, we have rank three. Now I'm going to arrange the students of a particular class according to their height in the increasing order or in the decreasing order. So what does that position indicate? That position indicates that number one is only indicating the position of the tallest person or maybe the shortest person taken in order. Now we talk about quality rankings. That's what where we that's a common example, or maybe the rankings of a team. That's team one, rank one, or rank two. Now here, when it comes to the marketing examples, we have maybe the preference ranking. You say talk about, yeah, I prefer this product over the other product. So it's a preference. And what do we use in the descriptive statistics is the percentile and the median. And moving on to the inferential statistics permissible is rank order, order correlation, or may talk about ANOVA. Now in interval scale, what we object is the difference between the object is taken. You have to find out, as I said, like in the case of maybe degree Celsius or maybe Fahrenheit, how do we say there is equal intervals of temperature? You look at the lines that are there. The first indicator is zero, then there are 10 divisions, it goes to the first 10, or maybe 10 divisions, it goes to a minus. And you'll find that there are equal distances between the equal points. So where do we use as an example is the attitude measurements or maybe the index measurements and so on. And the kind of descriptive statistic that we use is range, median, or maybe even standard deviation. Now here, when it comes to the inferential, we normally go for the product moment. Now moving on to the ratio, as I said, there's a fixed point which is known as the absolute zero we're talking about, but it again doesn't mean that it's zero and doesn't have a value, but zero point is fixed and you compare the scales of the ratio. So what is this? You fix up a the length of maybe the length of this board is to be measured. So you are taking the zero at this point and then you are taking and you're comparing this length with some other bigger board, or maybe we say the height of Ravi is two times the height of Hari. So how do we take? So it's a comparison. So ratio, that is what is taken into account here. So we have the ages. We have in the mass classes, normally we say father's age is two times, or uncle's age is two times the age of his son, and so on. So there are certain cases where we apply the ratio scale. What do we use in descriptive is the geometric mean, the harmonic mean, and of course, when it comes to the inferential, we use the coefficient of variation. Moving on to what is the other type of the scalings, which is actually the main topic of this module, we have comparative. With the word itself, it's comparative. So comparative scales involve the direct comparison of stimulus objects, and the data must be interpreted in relative terms. How there's something there where to compare with, like you say, one thing is better than the other. How do you compare? So whenever we want to use comparison, we are making use of this comparative scale. Similarly, when it is moving on to non-comparative scales, that means when we are talking about only a particular object, and then we want to compare the goods and the bads, or what is good in that particular, or we need to rate a particular object, in a point of 10 or 20 or 100. So we are not actually comparing one object with the other. So it is known as non-comparative scales. So we have non-comparative scales. So in each of them, we have another different set of scaling pattern. We will be looking into the detail. However, to make them identify what are those techniques under each of them, let me tell as this is paired comparison, wherein with the word itself, let's go by the word. We said comparative and non-comparative. You've got an idea, there's something which is compared and this something which is not compared. So when you're talking about paired comparison, which means there may be a product which is paired with another product. So it is a paired comparison, and then you make a comparison of that particular pair. Now when you talk about the rank order, how are you going to rank a particular, like say for example, brand A is better or brand B is better. How are you going to rank them? On what attributes, on what parameters? So that's, now again, there's a constant sum. So as I said, we'll be highlighting and putting emphasis on the words. Constant, which means there is some fixed value, and sum means we are adding up, which means constant sum is something where you are getting a value after adding something. Now, what are we going to do that? We are going to learn in our next coming slide. Then we have Q sort. So Q stands for Q, which means something which has been piled one above the other. So again, a quick look, comparative scales, we have paired comparison, we have rank order comparison, we have constant sum, and we also have the Q sort. Moving on to the non-comparative scales, that we have in two divisions. We have the continuous rating scale, and which is itemized rating scale, which is very, very commonly used. Now in itemized rating scale, we again have three different ways. The one is Likert scale, which is very commonly used in most of the questionnaires, and I'm sure everybody knows about it. Semantic differential scale is a very good technique which can be used by market researchers. And of course, then you have a staple scale, again, which is used by market researchers. So Likert scale is very common. As I said, it's used in market research also. You'll find in social sciences also, though these are also used in social science because it always used for comparison. And you know, the diagrammatic representations looks much beautiful. So as I said, we have here comparative scales. So when I said comparative, means we are making a comparison. Now, what is a comparison here? You have a Pepsi, you have Coke. Now, Pepsi and Coke are being together compared. So how is that? Which is better? On what parameters? On what attributes this is better? So we have come into the ordinal rank, and somewhere we call it as a non-metric. As I've already said, we are not actually putting these numbers to show that it has some value, but something to compare or to show which is good or bad. So moving on to this non-comparative scales, what have we done? In comparative, we took which is better. Was it Pepsi or was it Coke? Now here it is going to be, how am I going to rate Pepsi on the basis of the sweetness that it has? So what kind of a feedback are you going to give on a scale from 1 to 10? But I'm not comparing it with Coke this time. This is going to be only one product, and on one product, what is your take on it? So this is, we are using a non-comparative scale in this case. Now moving on to the comparative scaling techniques, the first on list is a paired comparison. So in the beginning, as I said, paired means there are two things taken together. Now here you have a combination. Now what do I do? The researchers, they may give to the respondents a set of two brands, a combination of two brands, brand one and brand two. Now here, suppose I take a combination of LG with Samsung, or maybe LG with Akai. Now, if I combine these two, what is your take and what is your score? So for example, here it said on a score of 15, you have to give the score to brand one and you have to give the score to brand 2. Say for example, for LG, I may give it as maybe 10, or maybe I give it here as 5. So this is how the 15 gets divided. So when we talk about here, in the second case, if we take LG, and then if I take of this Akai and LG, so it may be 8 in one case, and then you have the left as maybe 7 in the other case. So this 15 score will be divided among these two brands, and by looking at the combo pack, you know, what is the best, we can actually get an awareness about which two brands among the two. So here you say as 5 and you may take as 10, or maybe you set as 7 and you take it as 8 here. Now look at the combinations. So many a times this 15 marks, which is the combination that can be given? So how much, if I go a combination of this, which gets a bigger score? So it helps me to understand. Now the same example, you can say maybe a combination of Coca-Cola and Pepsi, would you prefer? Or maybe a combination of Dr. Pepper and Pepsi, maybe a combination of Coca-Cola and 7-Up, or maybe a combination of Dr. Pepper and 7-Up. So this combination actually helps, you know, to pick up two objects from a set of the entire base, and maybe this is done based on a specific criteria. Moving on to the rank order scaling. Now what do we do? This is also done very much by the marketeers. Now here I have taken the preference for toothpaste. I have taken different brands of toothpaste. I am asking the respondents to put them in the order of different preference. How do you prefer? So maybe on ranks 1 to 6, maybe I may put this as 1, they may be putting this as 2, maybe this as 3, and this as 4, maybe this as 5, and this is 6. So I come to know about how the respondents or the consumers are preferring the different kinds of the brands that are taken into question. Moving on to the constant sum. In the beginning, I did say that when you're talking about constant and sum, which means you're summing up and there has to be a constant. So in the constant sum scaling technique, what we actually do is we have here taken 3 segments of bathing soap. Now you take any, you take maybe Lux, you can take Dove, or maybe you can take Rexona, or anyway, your choice. Now these are the 3 different segments, and in this 3 different segments, I have identified few attributes on which I have to get them assessed. Now, what do the respondents do? I have given a constant value as 100 for each case. Now, the respondents can actually assign them the marks, so that we come to know about what is the marking for mildness of Lux. Maybe, oh, it is very mild. Say, I've got a value of 60 here. And how about lather? Lather, I would say, no, it's just 20. And maybe I'm just left with 20. So I have of 20 over here. So the total sum here has to come as equal to 100. So if I take the case of Dove, now what is the mildness? Oh, I say maybe it is 80. It is very mild. And then you may take 10, or you may take it as 10. What is required here is that sum total should be equal to the 100 points that are allotted. That also doesn't mean that it is always on a 100 point scale. That will depend upon the condition and the researcher and the area in which the research is taken care. So we have the same case for Rexona. So let's do it for Rexona as well. So maybe mildness, I'll say, oh, it is 50, and then I divide this as 25. They're just randomly giving the numbers just to get an idea about how do we sum up to get these constant values. Q sort. As I said, while we are talking about Q sort, this is the compiling of the values. How do we compile? there may be certain categories. Now here the categories assigned are sad, fearful, anxious and angry. These are the four different parameters. Now there may be small cards which are given to the respondents, and they will be asked, what do you think? Like say for example, now here it is depressed. Now the card of depressed under these four categories, and these can be numbered, you know, you can put them as numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, or they can be an order as say for example, you can file it as maybe 0, then as minus 1 with minus 2, minus 3, minus 4 and minus 5. And similarly, you can also have it as 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 and so on. Now, what happens in this case? Here, this 1 to 4, I've just taken the examples of 1 to 0 and then on left 5 and right positive 5. Now, what do I do? The respondents would put all those cards like under the sad category. So, it's depressed, it's sad, grieving, it's sad, sorrowful, is sad, melancholy, is sad. So, you have miserable, is sad and so on. So, you'll find a huge list being piling up, which is known as the Q sort. We are sorting it out according to what are the attributes or the parameters that has been taken into the question, right? So, when you look at and when you finalize, so you'll get a pattern like this. You get a pattern like this. So, whole here may be under the 5, there may be 10 or 15 attributes. Under here, there may be more attributes. So, you'll find a different pattern that comes out because each quality or whatever the characteristics that we have taken here is getting piled up under this. So, that is what is known as Q sort. So, this is a very good technique basically wherein the respondents are sorting out the objects that are being given and they are putting them into the piles according to the specified criteria. These criteria can be preference, can be attitude, can be perception and so on. And objects are sorted into these piles. Mainly, like say for example, 100 attributes are given and they may be asked to divide into 7 piles, 6 piles, 10 piles and ranging from the most agreeable to the most disagreeable. You know, you can take it as the most disagreeable. You can take it as most disagreeing to the most agreeing. So, the positive value can be taken as most agreeing. So, this is how it goes. In the non-comparative scaling techniques, this is a very good technique which is known as the continuous rating scale. Now, this is also referred as the graphic rating scale, and the respondents are asked to rate the objects by placing an appropriate mark on the line that is there. Say for example, here the question is, how would you rate Walmart as a departmental store? So, on to the left, we have, this is version number 1. There are different ways in which it can be written. We have version number 1, we have version number 2, we have also version number 3. So, in version number 1, probably the worst. And at the other end, you will have probably the best. So, what do the respondents do? They will put a horizontal or a vertical mark. So, here you find this is the mark. So, as an indicator that is it closer to probably the worst or is it closer to the probably the best. Similarly, there is another version. Now, if you look at here, we don't have any indicator values. But in the second version, we have all indicated values here. So, and now the respondent, when he marks this point, we get, as we as a researcher, will get an idea about where does this value lie. You know, where is the level of that indicator? So, here it comes between 40 to 50. Unlike in the previous case, as we said, we have no idea, but to say it's somewhere around 50, so it's less than 50. But in this case, it is an indicator that it is between 40 and 50. the third version where it is a little more in detail, where it talks about you have certain more categories, probably the worst. So up to here, it's probably the worst. Then maybe a bad, it's very bad. Then there is a slot for neither good nor bad, and then for very good, and towards the end you have probably the best. So greater than 90, it's now this also depends upon the researcher, on what is the area that he is going to explore and what is his intention and what is the kind of the research that he is into. So here, when this indicator line, the marking line, indicates that it is between 40 to 50, but it is something which is very bad, which is very bad. So there's more of detailing that is being done. So depending upon the research, you can go in. This is a very good technique whenever you want to use, the continuous rating scales. Moving on to the non-comparative scales, we have the itemized scales, as we were talking about, the continuous and the itemized. So with the name itself, it is saying itemized. So it indicates there's some kind of item in that. So what are these items? So here the respondents are provided with a scale that definitely should have some number or something which is associated with each category, so that he evaluates a particular situation. Now here, very commonly used are the Likert scale, as I've already said in the beginning, the semantic differential scale, and then the Staples scale. Let's look into the details of each of them and how one is different from the other. Looking into the very common Likert scale, this is named after the developer Rensis Likert, and the Likert scale is widely used rating scale because that is very common for degree of agreement or disagreement of several statements about a certain stimulus objects. Now, what is the significance of this? Basically, you will look at it. It has five responses. You can have five different category of responses, varying from strongly agree to strongly disagree. Now, you can have a set of questions wherein you have the strongly agree statement. Now, however, the order can be reversed: the agreement statement, the neutral, disagreement, and the highly disagreement statement. So, I am fully focused at my job. So, it's an indicator that the respondents wants to put yes, he agrees, so you can tick on highly agree. So according to what is the attribute, what are the different kinds of the questions that are put for the respondents are given five different choices. Keep in mind, a Likert scale has five different levels, basically moving from a strongly agreement statement to a strongly disagreement level. Moving on to, again, this is something which looks very beautiful once a research is done, and you can compare a brand one with brand two. Now, what is the importance of this? Is it has a seven, it has a seven level, it has seven pointing scales, and you will look, it has bipolar labels. One end you'll find if it's powerful, you'll find at the other end it is weak. If you have on one end it is unreliable, you'll find at the other end it is reliable. Now here we look at, so it says good, and at the end you'll find it is bad, and you have certain pointers. And keep in mind, Likert also has a neutral point, and semantic differential scale also has a neutral point. So you have a zero over here. Now this is on the energy. How is the energy, good or bad? Is it weak or is it strong? Is it active or is it passive? Is it wet or dry? Talking about cold, meaningful, fresh, bright, brave and beautiful. And you will find on the other hand is all the opposites, and that's the reason why it is termed as bipolar. It has two extreme ends. So the negative adjective or phrase sometimes appears on the left or maybe onto the right. That depends upon the researchers. Now, how do you go by? You know, you can also compare. Maybe say, for example, you are comparing the energy of you are comparing brand one, and then you are talking about brand maybe two. And suppose if this is the value for brand one, and then you will find that, say for example, you can join up all these lines, so you get a beautiful graph like this, say for example, right? Now here, let me bring about another change and how this variations in the second band. Suppose say for example, I have my second brand values as here, and I have values here. I'm just not looking at the statements, I'm just marking so that I get my lines, and I have it here, this, and I've just chosen some blind points just to get how to compare and how does this figure finally looks at, right? So here and then look. Now look at, you get a pattern here drawn, which indicates very quickly by looking at the graph that how are the two brands in terms of the different items that have been taken here. And coming to the last of the comparative scale is the staple scale. The staple scale is a unipolar rating scale, but here there are 10 categories. You have 10 categories. And what is the significance of this? That it doesn't have a neutral point. So you look at here, it doesn't have a zero. The zero is vanishing. So you can rate, you can use it, like say for example, ranging from -5 to maybe +5, but with no zero. So you have -1 to -5, 5 scales, and you have 1 to 5, 5 scales. So indicate how accurately or inaccurately each term describes. You know, you can use this for various questionnaires. Now here it is asked, high food quality. Now how are you going to rate? And it's rated that a +4 is given. What was the question? The question was, how do you rate high food quality? So here you have 5 scales above and you have 5 scales below. Now similarly, a question is here to be answered, which is, how is the poor crew services? Now when you look at the poor crew services, it has been rated as +3. So it's, how poor was it? You know, so you can have both positive questions and both negative. However, this is being written vertically. It can also be written as +5, you can +4, maybe +3 and +2 and +1. And then, you know, you can have it on the horizontal scale also, maybe +1, +2, +3, +4 and +5, and towards the negative as -3, -4 and -5. So this is, keep in mind, the staple scale has 10 points. To review again, we need to think about Likert scale has 5 points, it has a neutral point. Semantic differential scale has 7 points, it also has a neutral point. But staple points has 10 points, but then it doesn't have a neutral point. So that was all for this module. Hope you enjoyed learning. Thank you.